the magnetism of the Bible. It's with us once again as we come to Book by Book and the seventh session in our study of the Acts of the Apostles. I'm Richard Bewes. I'm joined here by Paul Blackham, longtime colleague, and then by George Verwer, who is on his way through the UK right now, and we're glad to have you with us again, George, for study number seven. And so we're opening up at Acts chapter 15 and 16 today, as we come to really a boiling up controversy that was involving the people of God in this the early church movement. It says here, verse 5, I'm reading chapter 15, verse 5 onwards. Then some of the believers who belonged to the party of the Pharisees stood up and said, "The Gentiles must be circumcised and required to obey the law of Moses." The apostles and elders met to consider this question. After much discussion, Peter got up and addressed them, "Brothers, you know that some time ago God made a choice among you that the Gentiles might hear from my lips the message of the gospel and believe God. God, who knows the hearts, shows that he accepted them by giving the Holy Spirit to them, just as he did to us. He made a distinction between us and them, for he purified their hearts by faith. Now then, why do you try to test God by putting on the necks of the disciples a yoke that neither we nor our fathers have been able to bear? No, we believe it is through the grace of our Lord Jesus that we are saved, just as they are." So you can see what is happening, friends. There was the first big doctrinal test coming up before the church, the early church. And it was a big test for them. It looked like a tiny thing, but it was bigger than what we might have imagined. So Acts 15, verse 1, Paul Blackham, has been described as the most important background verse for understanding of Paul's letters. See, some men came down from Judea to Antioch and were teaching the brothers, "Unless you are circumcised according to the custom taught by Moses, you can't be saved." Why the controversy?
Well, this is such a massive background thing, because Paul has all these letters and he's constantly going on about this issue about, well, it's partly like, do you have to do all the laws of Moses in order to be saved? And then it's got the wider consequences down through history. Is any religion of any good, is religion of any use at all in terms of being right with the living God and all this? And this blockbuster controversy right in the middle of the New Testament, and it comes up time and time again, is just constantly getting to this issue, is can we do anything? Like, if we have, you know, we might say, "Oh, I'm okay, I'll be all right when I get to heaven because I kept the Ten Commandments," or "I went to church," or in them the issue is, "I've been circumcised." And it's really the reason it's all there is to just say, no, it isn't anything to do with any of that sort of thing. What it's about is trusting and loving and following Jesus, the living God in flesh, the living God who's a human being, who came among us, taught us, died for us, rose again. We love and trust and follow him. That's the only thing that can get us right with the living God.
And that's the thing that we have to take hold of then today. It's a controversy often involving us. False teaching is one of the big things that Paul was always on about, just to try and correct that young church. Well, George Verwer, as I'm looking on at verse 2 onwards, the very first, we could call it an ecumenical, a big round-the-table conference of the church, was held in Jerusalem. Big item on the agenda was this very thing. Do the non-Jewish followers of Jesus need to keep the law of Moses? How did James conclude the matter? Because he's right at the fore of all of this.
Well, they decided that it was salvation by grace. Verse 11, "No, we believe it is through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ that we are saved." And then they decided to send this letter back to Antioch. And it's quite interesting how they chose two other people, sort of neutral people, to carry that letter. And they put in a few little, like, legalistic compromises, in my view, but they were, especially one of them was good, that they would especially abstain from immorality. "You are to abstain from food sacrificed to idols, from blood, from the meat of strange strangled animals, and from sexual immorality." So it's obvious that it was going to be a process, because later we see Timothy getting circumcised. That's another whole little interesting thing. But we'll basically, the decision was made that Gentiles do not have to be circumcised, but we want them to keep some of these basic basic rules.
Hey, listen, I, as a Gentile, am very thankful to Almighty God that somehow I've been let in by the side gate.
Yeah.
I haven't had to go through all the Jewish ceremonials or anything like that. I've come by the side into the covenant of the Lord. And it's a wonderful privilege. And
one of the things that really helps me in this passage is that as OM became much bigger in the mid-80s, I formed an executive group. Before that, I was leading the thing on my own, always in consultation, but we didn't have an official executive group for Jerusalem-style meetings. And I often found those meetings hard, and I thought a lot of it seems to be a waste of time. And I was really helped from this passage that in the early church, if they had to have meetings, and we were always dealing with controversy. Every time we met, there was some kind of controversy.
Well, we're always dealing with controversy the whole time.
And it just encouraged me that the book of Acts had all this kind of nuts and bolts stuff. It wasn't all just the spiritual things, the word and prayer, the word and prayer, win people to Jesus. There were these problems, there were disagreements, and that really helped me in my 46 years of leading Operation Mobilization and this executive group that met three times a year. And we need to understand what's written here is still going on today in God's work all over the world. We shouldn't be frightened by it or intimidated by it, but just go for it as unto the Lord.
Exactly. I mean, and it can be exhausting work too. Well, as they came through this with flying colors, they got it sorted out, which is a wonderful thing for the whole of the church of the future. Then it goes on, as we get into chapter 15, they go on to a mission going on. When Paul says to Barnabas, let's go back and visit the brothers in all the towns. That's verse 36 onwards. Then there was, again, a bit of a personal problem because Paul couldn't accommodate
Mark.
Who'd been a bit of a letdown and in the past. But Barnabas saw the real potential of the young man. Though they've actually parted company over, over the inclusion of Mark. Paul Blackham, what does this tell us about, well, about Paul and about Mark and all the rest of it?
Well, it's good because Paul's this, you know, he is this amazingly passionate activist, you know, really uncompromising and everything. And Mark, we don't know exactly what happened, but he seems to have sort of bailed out of the missionary journey at some point.
He left him down somewhere.
Somewhere, and he doesn't even detail. But it's, and Paul's like, right, that's it. He's muffed it, forget it. He's out. I can't use someone like that. He's unreliable. Whereas Barnabas is this much more... maybe a mature person in a way, and he's openly saying, no, no, Mark's real quality. I know this guy. He's going to come good. Paul won't have it, and he's like, no, forget it. I'm picking someone else now. I'm moving on. And, of course, you think, well, what did happen to Mark? Well, we know what happened to him. He wrote the biography of Jesus, Mark's gospel. He did come good, and Paul himself acknowledges that in 2 Timothy 3:11, where he says, yeah, Mark's such a, he's such a good guy. And that's that lesson about Paul and Mark. One is Mark, that there's a, okay, he's made a mistake, but that wasn't the end of his life and usefulness.
No.
There's lots he could do. Well, you know, there's a second chance. But also with Paul, some of us can be maybe too passionate, too uncompromising. But again, as time goes on, the Lord can make us more gracious and more
And Mark, in fact, is reinstated because later on, Paul is able to say, get Mark and bring him to me.
Exactly.
He's been very useful.
Yeah.
So that was a wonderful reinstatement of somebody who had some kind of a lapse. But Barnabas, hats off to Barnabas for having helped, as he obviously did. After that big controversy of Acts 15, George, or the Council of Jerusalem, you were saying that later on, Paul circumcised Timothy, and there it is in Acts chapter 16, verses 1 to 5. So they have that Jewish ceremony performed on Timothy. Would you like to comment on why that should have happened?
Well, I think it's important to realize that what we have recorded here doesn't necessarily indicate that it was right. And maybe it wasn't right for Paul to circumcise him. We'll, I guess, know in eternity. But his mother was Jewish. Mm. So I think on the basis of him wanting to be a peacemaker, maybe he was learning after this bust-up with Barnabas that he should have more of a peacemaking element in his ministry. And so he did this, I think, to try to win over the Jews, who were still steaming about this. This controversy, you know, didn't go away. In some ways, it may hadn't gone away yet. So I think it's an area where there's peacemaking, there's seemingly compromise, and different people will have different viewpoints. I'm glad that this is in the scriptures, because we see Christian leaders having bust-ups today, and some of the followers get really depressed by that and even discouraged. Whereas I think part of the problem is unrealistic view of leaders. Leaders are clay pots, they're human vessels. They'll have their problems. We shouldn't let that discourage us. And the fact that God put this in scripture, as well as this circumcision thing of Timothy, I think encourages us to press on in our own weaknesses and struggles, and to be willing at times for compromise on issues that are not that important.
Yeah.
Oh, George, you've seen it all in your own ministry, and I'm sure you'll continue to see more in the days to come, but it's very helpful to hear of that experience from you as well. Actually, Paul Blackham, as we come on into chapter 16 further, the mission goes on.
Yeah.
The journey on, the Spirit, it says, drives Paul and Timothy over to Macedonia. Then they get to Philippi. What's the significance of Philippi?
Well, it's phenomenally important, this moment where the Antioch mission project is now going into Europe. And these Asian missionaries, because of course Europe was won to be followers of Jesus by Asian missionaries. You know, Christianity is an Asian movement in that sense, and it comes and invades Europe. And this is the kind of one of the key moments when that happens, when the sent across into Europe these Asian missionaries.
And they tried to go elsewhere first.
They were sort of thinking, no, let's just stay in Turkey and let's kind of loop back round and go back to Antioch. And they can't. And however the Holy Spirit prevents them, that's what happens. And he kind of pushes them across into Europe. And they arrive at this city of Philippi, 16 verse 12, a Roman colony, the leading city of that district of Macedonia. And it's so strategic for the area and these sort of things that happen. This woman, Lydia, she becomes a follower of Jesus right away. Leading person in the
city.
Another
name.
Another one of these names.
The first European convert named Lydia.
Yeah, Lydia. And what's so strategic, you think, what does this mean for the history of the world that Europe, from here, we're reading about it in Acts 16, becomes not a continent of paganism or worshipping a Roman Empire or the Norse gods of Thor and Odin or the Wicca religions or the Druids. None of that. It becomes a continent that becomes shaped deeply, fundamentally by Jesus. The consequences of that for the world are unbelievable.
Yeah, and it starts with this one person, Lydia. Yeah. I think it's wonderful to read about. Well, George, then, of course, there's a bust up, naturally, to Philippi, because Paul and Silas are arrested for what they're doing. They're thrown into jail. They're put in the stocks. They're beaten up. It's one of the great scenes in the whole book of Acts, in Acts 16, when they're singing hymns at midnight. The earthquake takes place. They're released from the earthquake, from prison by the earthquake, but they stay put. They don't move, preaching the gospel. A little later, when they are released, why does Paul actually insists on a public apology next day from the Romans? Why is that?
I just wanted to pick up, before I comment on that I was really encouraged with this going to Europe. And I think it's really important that people read that carefully, that the first two directions that the great apostle Paul attempted to move, it didn't work. He was stopped.
That's right. Tried to get
Somebody preach on this once, and I almost keeled over in laughter because he brought a lot of humor in. Because so many people are writing me, emailing me, they're having trouble knowing God's will. And they get discouraged because they go down one road, they think they should join OM, and suddenly the money doesn't come in and it doesn't happen. And I think we need to realize that finding the will of God is not always some simple little snap of the finger and the blueprint drops down. And I'd like you to answer that. This last question.
Yeah. Well, I mean, this public apology is so important because it's very important that the followers of Jesus are not labeled as outlaws or civil disobedient people or troublemakers. And they've been backed into this corner, locked up for being followers of Jesus. And Paul's like, no, we're not having this. I'm a Roman citizen. The followers of Jesus are the best people to have in a society. They're the people who keep the law. They're the best citizens. So you've locked us up. No, we want you to publicly. He's not doing it for his own sake. He's thinking about all these other Christians in all these other cities. And he does not want a sort of memo to go around all the governors of all the cities. Like, watch out for the Christians. He wants to make sure the memo that goes around is the Christians are good. They're not troublemakers, and we had to apologise because we falsely accused them.
Yeah, I like that very much. Actually, as T.R. Glover, the historian, once said, Christianity stabilises society without sterilising it. Yeah. That's a great comment, and Paul is insistent that that should be the truth in this particular occasion. We're winding up, friends. We've had a wonderful time, very quickly, with Acts 15 and 16. I mean, it's a story, once again, of individuals coming to the fore. So there's James there, very key man at the Council of Jerusalem. Luke comes to the fore because for the first time we hear the word we coming into the passages. So he's been incorporated. Maybe he was the man speaking at midnight in the dream to Paul. There's Lydia, the first convert. There's the occult girl who's saved by the Lord through the ministry of Paul. There's the jailer, who also becomes a Christian after that earthquake. So it reminds us that you never know what God is doing with just one person. How about you? See, in my little autograph album as a child, I had words written by my grandpa that feature there. I am only one, but I am one. I cannot do everything, but I can do something. What I can do, I ought to do. And what I ought to do, by the grace of God, I will do. May God bless each one of us who have something to do for the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.